There goes my heart beating, 'cause you are the reason I'm losing my sleep. Please come back now. And there goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing. I'm hopeless now. I'd climb every mountain and swim every ocean just to be with you and fix what I broke. Oh, 'cause I need you to see.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we gather today, I'm going to begin by inviting Stan Jarrett to come forward and offer an acknowledgement to country. Thank you, Stan.
Before I do that, I just want to thank all the travellers from travelling a long way to come and see our brother Max on Mackie John, see him off. I want to give our condolences from the Gerringong Stewart's family up there and the Jarretts from up in Gerringong. With that, I'd like to acknowledge the country that we stand on today on this service. For Mackie John, so thank you.
Thank you, Stan, for that welcome to country. And may I welcome you too. And more importantly, we gather because we know that God welcomes you. God welcomes you as his first peoples of this land that he has made. God welcomes you as his people seeking comfort and healing and hope. And God welcomes you as family and friends of Mackie John, Max John McLeod. We gather today to farewell Max and to hand him into God's care. Indeed, in this funeral service, we are trying to do three things. First, we gather to mourn Max's death, to grieve and sit together in our sorrow. Second, we gather to celebrate Max's life, to remember our times with him and the person that he was. And third, we gather to lift our hearts to God, that we might know God's healing and love in this time, and to know that our hope and joy as Christians is that death is not the end of the story, but that Christ, who has conquered death, is calling us to new eternal life in him. And so I invite you to pray. Loving God, you alone are the source of life. And may your life-giving spirit flow through us and fill us with compassion one for another. Lord, in our sorrow, give us the calm of your peace. Lord, kindle our hope and let our grief in time give way to joy. And we ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So that we might frame this gathering through the lens that was Max, I invite now Uncle Mike to come and offer a eulogy. Thanks, Mike.
Welcome, everyone, as we come together to remember and celebrate the life of Max Mackie John, Mad Max McLeod. I'd like to start off by acknowledging the elders who are here with us today, as well as those that could not make it be with us, and the contributions they make to their communities. To those who have travelled far and wide, I would like to welcome you to Max's country. On behalf of Bernie, Angie, and their family, Thanks everyone for coming here today to celebrate, remember and celebrate Max's life. There are many who would have dearly liked to have been here today, but due to circumstances, could not. We would like to thank them for their thoughts and prayers at this time. Max touched the lives of so many people. Bernie would like to send his acknowledgement, appreciation, and special mention to PJ, Adam, and Joel for having to endure one of the hardest nights ever on the night of Max's passing. While we are here to farewell Max, we're also here to remember and celebrate the wonderful times we had with him. While Max was taken from us far too early, he nonetheless had a remarkable life and has left an enduring impression on everyone who was fortunate to have met him. He'll be sadly missed, but fondly remembered. Max John McLeod was born on 24th October 1968 at Shoalhaven District Hospital, now in New South Wales. He passed away around the 7th of April 2021 at Jervis Bay, age 52. He was the loving son of Max and Elaine McLeod, both deceased, from Wreck Bay, Narrabri. He was the loving brother of Bernard and Angelina. He was a beloved grandson of Arthur McLeod and Angelina McLeod, Nee Chapman, both deceased, and Charlie Trindle and Lila Trindle, Nee Callaghan, both deceased. He was a loved nephew of Les, Victor, David and Kevin, all deceased, Sharon, Donna, Alfred, deceased, Shirley, who's deceased, Iris, Darcy is deceased, Arthur, Tasman or Taz, deceased, Bonnie, Yvonne, Charlie and Lawrence, the brother-in-law to Narelle McLeod and Kenny Brown, uncle to Shania, Kanika, Keaton, Adam, Thomas, Maddie, Kiala, Tyler and Yolara, and great-uncle to Sage, Koa and Carter, as well as many cousins, too many to mention here. Max's early years were spent living at Wreck Bay and Jervis Bay, as well as some of the surrounding towns. We couldn't quite work out which ones. At Wreck Bay, he lived with his grandparents, as well as his uncle Victor and Auntie Iris. He was a bright, healthy baby until he contracted meningitis just before his first birthday. After this, it was noticed that he was not communicating well, and he was diagnosed with profound deafness. This, of course, was to shape his and his family's lives for years to come. Early and young Max didn't crawl. He went straight from sitting to walking. A very clever and coordinated child. This became more evident as he got older. In January 1968, Max and Elaine had another son, Bernard. Much later, in July 1984, Angelina came along to complete the family. Mackie John's deafness posed a number of issues for his parents. There was an offer for him to attend the Centre for Deaf and Blind Children at North Roxton, Sydney. However, that would have meant moving away from family and all the family support that was so crucial. He could not attend a local school at Jervis Bay, as they did not have the resources to cater for his needs. Fortunately, an OD, Opportunity Deaf Class, was started at East Nowra's Public School. Young Max was in the inaugural OD class at school. He would catch the bus from Wreck Bay, Jervis Bay to East Nowra each morning to attend school. Fortunately, he had plenty of support in his auntie Sharon and Donna, who were attending high school at the time, to make sure he got on the bus and behaved properly. Each day he was met at school by his school principal, Mrs. Tanner, and put on the bus for home afterwards. Max's teacher was Miss Newton, who he adored. The bus trips to school were taking a toll on Mackie John, so his parents decided to move into Nowra and were able to obtain a house in East Nowra. This was home until after he left high school. Growing up deaf with limited communication skills led to many interesting situations. Many people, especially relatives, mentioned that Max was often a torment. One of my earliest recollections of Max after I came on the scene in 1975 was of this energetic child who, when he came out to Wreck Bay to see his grandparents, would hit the house full of energy. Poor Max and Elaine would be trying to keep him calm and out of things he wasn't supposed to be in. Bernie would often be the target of Mackie John's tormenting and would often get into trouble for retaliating. Of course, much of this behaviour was related to his lack of ability to communicate with others. When out at Wreck Bay, there was always one person who could calm him down, his beloved Nanny. Her calm voice and gentle stroking would soothe him. She would put camphor on his chest, along with a healing paper. At the time at Wreck Bay, to get electricity, you had to put 2 bobs, 20 cent pieces, for those who don't know that, into the meter box. If the money ran out, the electricity went off, and you had to fumble around in the dark to find 2 bobs to start the electricity again. One day, Mackie John was at his grandparents' place when the 2 bobs ran out. So everyone else was rushing around in the dark to find coins. Mackie John was running around in the dark also. An accident waiting to happen, and it did. Mackie John ran into a chair or table and knocked out one of his top teeth. When the power came on, everyone was running around trying to find the tooth. However, this didn't slow him down. Mackie John never learned to sign. His parents didn't want him to be seen as different to others of his age. So he learned to lip read. He eventually became very proficient at lip reading, and as most of you know, could hold a conversation with the best of us. I read somewhere that our first and best friends are our cousins. In Max's case, this was very true. From a very early age, his best friend was his cousin Ronald, who he always referred to as his brother Ronald. Whatever Ronald was into, so was Max. If Ronald was still here today, I bet he could have told a lot of stories about the mischief the two got into. Ronald also had to be careful, as Max would not hesitate to dobbing him to Auntie Iris and Uncle Victor. When Ronald started playing soccer, Max was there, although too young to play. Mackie John started playing at 6 years old for Huskisson. It was a bit of a learning curve. Max was always well coordinated, throwing, catching and kicking balls from a young age. In his first game, he tackled a player and won the ball. He looked up and saw an open goal and took off. There was only one problem. It was the opposition's goal. His father was behind Max's team's goal, trying to get him to turn around on the side, and on the sideline was Uncle Victor jumping up and down, yelling for him to go the other way. It was all to no avail, as he couldn't hear a thing they were saying. He scored a goal for the other team. That was the last time that happened. Max was good at any sport he put his mind to. Ronald decided to play rugby league, so did Max. He was a very handy winger. He was also the goal kicker. It was always interesting to watch Max lining up for the kicks for goal, especially from the sideline. One of the best memories Bernie and Angie had of Max playing football was when he scored a try. However, he was thrown a forward pass. Due to being deaf, he couldn't hear the ref's whistle for being offside and ran to the end of the field to score a try. He jumped around celebrating, only to be told, no try. The proud look on his face and actually believing he had scored was a moment we will never forget. But to see him misunderstand what had happened and the expression on his face after being told it was not a try was devastating and disappointing. But it will still be a moment to celebrate. The opposition supporters would try to heckle him to put him off his concentration off, especially when he was kicking goals. Of course, that had no effect on Max, as they could shout all they wanted and he didn't hear them. While the supporters were amazed by his ability to keep focus, when told why, they were amazed even further. He played rugby league for Nowra Warriors and Rec Bay Bears, always one of the most valuable players on the team. After leaving school, he worked for a short time at the National Botanic Gardens at Jervis Bay with his father. But soon his real calling came, painting. He obtained a painting apprenticeship and took to it like a duck to water. Every Friday he would travel to Wollongong TAFE for classes. His commitment to his trade was recognised when he was named New South Wales TAFE Aboriginal Apprentice of the Year in 1994. There were over 7,000 Aboriginal people attending TAFE in New South Wales that year. In the same year, he was named NAIDOC Aboriginal Apprentice of the Year. He truly loved his work. After finishing his apprenticeship, he continued working for his boss and then worked for another company for a short while. In the end, he worked for the Rec Bay Aboriginal Community Council. Max probably painted every house at Rec and in the village. The good thing about working for the community was that his fellow workers looked after him. In particular, Paul Campbell and Jeff McLeod took Max under their wings and made sure that things were right for him at work and always looked after him. If you did not want a critique of your house painting ability, it was not wise to invite Max into your home. The first thing he looked at was the walls and ceilings. He would ask who painted the walls, and if it was you, he would carefully inspect your handiwork, pointing out any issues. He was a perfectionist with his painting and expected others to be the same. Matthew John's parents were very protective of him, as would any parents be given the circumstances with his hearing impairment, especially back in those days. Max lived a very challenging lifestyle and found it very hard to understand, relate and learn to communicate in a very trying world. This was difficult for Max as a child, but was overcome in later years by lip reading and adventuring through life. In the latter part of Max's life, Facebook and social media was something he lived off. It also became his way of bettering his communication and contacts throughout his everyday life. He loved Facebook and was on it 24/7. One of his greatest quotes being, "Cops looking for you." He loved to go out with family and friends and have a good time. Much to everyone's amazement, Max loved to dance. Max learned through images, photos, and mainly watching the TV show Rage, where he taught himself how to relate to the music and lyrics through vibrations and lip reading. When asked how he could hear the music, he would explain he felt the vibrations. He could even recognise songs. Angie tells the story about driving him one day. He was annoying her, so she turned on some music. He immediately began to bop to the music. She asked him if she knew the song. Of course, he said it was Jimmy Barnes, working class man. He was right. Family was so important to Max. When younger, he loved to go fishing with his dad, brother and pop, or go up to Gerringong to fish with Uncle Roy Stewart and family. Max did not have any children of his own, but like his Uncle Kevin, his nieces and nephews were his children. He would torment them just like everyone else. From Keaton, who we call White Girl, it has taken me one whole week to write this. It still doesn't feel real to me. Every day, I've been waiting for you to pull up in my driveway, ring the doorbell just to ask me to take you shopping, give you my mail, or even just come over to show me something on your phone. You're the best uncle anyone could ask for. No matter what went on, you were always there. I'm going to miss your face. You definitely made me laugh trying to understand you or even when trying to write out a shopping list. You'd always be trying your hardest to explain what you wanted from the shops. You meant the world to me, Uncle. I'll miss you dearly. See you in a dream time, Mad Max. You're finally back with your mum and dad. As you always said, you were the favourite. One of the everyday sayings on Facebook comments was, cops look for you. I love you, Mackie John. From Shania, or Tall Girl as you call her. I will forever remember that Uncle Max would call my son Carter, baby KKK. I was honoured. Uncle Max got given the chance to meet Carter as I was actually due to have Carter the day after Uncle Max's birthday, and always hoped that I had him on Uncle Max's birthday. Uncle Max had already had it organised for me to have Carter's first birthday this year on Uncle Max's birthday. Sadly, this won't happen. From Kanika, or we call her Black Girl. I will cherish the memories of visiting Uncle Max. Every time I took the girls to go see him, Sage would always try his hardest to try to talk to him using his hands and talking slow for him to understand. Uncle Max's face would light up every time. I'm just blessed that Sage will now have the beautiful memories he got to create with him and will always remember how strong their bond was. When Max got his mobile phone, he was in heaven. He could now torment his cousins, brother and sister without having to be there face to face. How many of us got strange cryptic messages from Max? You often had to sit and think about what the message was, but if you knew Max, you could work it out. It also meant that he wouldn't get stuck if you went out and couldn't find a lift home. He could text or ring a family member to come and get him. Even before his mobile, he knew Auntie Donna's number and would ring her from a public phone to come and pick him up. If he was with Auntie Donna while she was talking to Auntie Sharon, he would get on the phone and tell Auntie Sharon everything, even though she couldn't reply to him. Another word that some used to describe Max was he's a real dory. He knew all the gossip. I think people thought because he was deaf, he wouldn't know what they were talking about. They could not have been more wrong. He knew it all and would not hesitate to share it. As his Auntie Iris said, if Mackie John started by saying, and do you know, that's when you needed to get comfortable because you were in for a long conversation with him. When you were talking to Max, he always referred to his mum and dad as my mother or my father. Likewise, Bernie was always referred to as my brother and Angie as my sister. And he inherited one particular trait from his mother, keeping an immaculate house. Everything had its place and he loved the house to be spotless. As his father and mother's health deteriorated, he did what he could to help, but at times things would get frustrating for him as he, like the rest of us, did not fully understand what was happening. In June 2014, his father passed away, which was a big blow for him. Not long after, his mother needed to go into coastal waters due to her deteriorating condition. He visited her as often as possible and was devastated on her passing in March 2018. After his father's death, he needed to become more independent. Although they were younger than him, Bernie and Angie stepped up to look after him. He was also there to look after them too. As he often reminded Angie, I'm number one. At the same time, they helped him become more independent. After the passing of Max's parents, Bernie helped him get his driver's license and boating license. Max could now get around by himself. At the same time, Cousin Eileen and Auntie Donna were there when he needed assistance and advice. In recent times, Max had a few health issues, but nothing so serious to be life-threatening. That is why his sudden death was such a shock to everyone. The night of the 7th of April, when Bernie rang Auntie Sharon to tell her that Max had passed away peacefully in his sleep, will go down as one of the darkest days in our family's history. The shock was like somebody had run us all over by a truck. As is always the case, when things settled down, we were able to reflect on what had happened, although still stunned. Bernie expressed how he felt. Words can't describe the way I'm feeling now, and I'm absolutely shattered. I couldn't have asked for a better brother. You're my idol, and despite being deaf, you didn't let it affect you. I'm so proud of you and all the achievements you made. I'm going to miss you tormenting, brah. Love you, brother, and rest in peace. Likewise, Angie put up her feelings. I never thought I would be here writing a post about one of my brothers passing so soon in life, but here it is. Feeling overwhelmed by my news feed, as it's all about you, so many people sharing their special memories of you. I always knew you was a well-known and respected man, but I'm complete in shock by the amount of people you have touched. I'm in total shock and disbelief that you are no longer here with us. You wasn't just my brother, and you was my best friend. You supported me, protected me, and always reminded me you was the number one child. Me and Bernie Trindle McLeod were so lucky to have had you as an older brother. You were caring and loving and also a torment, but I wouldn't have wanted any other way. You was a great role model and the best uncle our kids could ask for. You was always there when they needed you, as they were there for you. They are heartbroken and I love you dearly. We've been through a lot of tears and laughter. We had our ups and downs. That never changed how much I love you. I'm so proud of you, and I'm sorry I wasn't there, but remember I love you. Say hello to Mum and Dad. Safe journey until we meet again, brother Yarrabee. All of Max's cousins are saddened by his sudden passing, and they will miss his mischievous Facebook messages and tormenting humour. He will always love his many aunties, uncles, cousins, and many friends. He will always be remembered and loved by all. At times like this, it's easy to try to look for some reason for what happened or to blame someone for the taking of someone so dear to us. Max found comfort and solace in his family and friends. Talking about the person and his or her life was a way that he was able to come to terms with his loss. We ask that you do the same. Remember Max for the wonderful person he was. Have a good laugh about the funny things. Shed the tears that need to be shed, and raise a glass to his memory. Max will continue to live in our hearts so long as we remember him. Mackie John treasured life and everything that came with it. He was incredibly curious about things around him and the people who made up his life. We will treasure the times we had with Max and will maintain the memories of him throughout the days ahead. Max had a huge impact on the life of family, friends and colleagues. His legacy will be the impact he will continue to have on these people. Our consolation is that Max is now at peace with his beloved mother and father. I'd like to end with a short verse that Max's uncle Kevin liked. In the twilight softly glowing, at the end of the day, in the twilight of the evening, I'll remember you each day. In the words of the Monero people, also Max's people, Yarrabee Mackie John, see you later. Got to go now.
Thanks, Mike. So we've heard Mike's reflection there and gatherings from thoughts from the family. And now I invite Paul to come forward and offer some words from those who knew Max through work. Thanks very much, Gunj.
I've been mates with Max. For 30 years. We began working together at Wreck Bay Council at the same time 20 years ago. The loss of Max in our workplace, it is the loss of a family member. The staff have lost a cousin, an uncle, a nephew, and for me, it feels like I've lost my brother. Max and I work two out nearly all the time. He would always work hard, no matter what the job. Max was an outstanding painter, a true craftsman. He had an excellent eye for detail. His ability to remember was invaluable. He could remember things from many years ago accurately. He always knew where a tool or bracket or screws were, even if they were in the shed from more than 10 years ago. Max was mostly pretty quiet and reserved. However, if he'd had a big night, he would come to work and be a real chatterbox. For a man who couldn't hear, he knew all the gossip. When Max was annoyed, usually with me or Jeff, he wouldn't talk to us. Nor would he look at us, so we couldn't talk to him. And when he did talk to us, he would say, "I don't care. It's not my problem." He'd done us every time. Max would mostly be in the car with me, as he didn't have a license till a few years ago. We would go to Ison's at Husky all the time, where he knew all the lads. And one of the lads there gave him a nickname of Bradman. And I asked the lad, "Why'd you call him that?" He said, "Well, he sits in the car and he never gets out." I helped Max get his driver's license after many years of trying to convince him he could do it. The first time we went for a drive in the manual work ute was a harrowing experience for me, and I think for Max too. But he ended up getting his license. I was proud of him that day. Max was my mate. He had my back, and I had his. If I'm picking a team of lads that I can rely on, Max is the first picked.
Good words. Thank you. Good words. Good words, heartfelt words. I invite the family now who are going to offer a poem.
Thanks, girls.
Do not stand at my grave. Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I am the thousand winds that blow. I am the diamond glint on snow. I am the sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn rain. I am the shining star at night when you wake to the morning light. I am the fisherman of the Yuin Nation. I am the cotton and the wheat of the Gomeroi people. I am the warrior from the mountains to sea, Yarrabee. I am the wind and the rain that will forever remind you of me. My time has come. I am at rest. I am the sunset in the west. I am the clouds that race above, where I watch over those I love. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not there. I do not die. So hear these words that here I say. I love, I am the love that guides your way.
Thank you, thank you. And in that time there of reflection of our two eulogies and the poem as reflection, what they might have done is stirred in your own hearts memories of your time with Max. And so I invite you now to sit as we watch this slideshow of some images that Angie's gathered and will share for us now with a musical accompaniment.
Rest.
Lovely. Thanks, Ange. Thanks, Bernie. Thanks, family, for putting that together. Some wonderful images. Let's take those reflections of our own and from what we've heard of Max's life and turn now to the scriptures. And the scripture I want to offer you today is from John's Gospel in chapter 21. Simon Peter said to the disciples, "I'm going fishing." And they said to him, "We will go with you." And they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach. But the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, "You have no fish, have you?" And they answered, "No." He said, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat and you will find some." And so they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he jumped into the sea and swam ashore. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." And so Simon Peter went aboard the boat and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." We've heard something of Max's life in the eulogies. We've seen something of Max's life in the slideshow. And we each have known something of Max's life in our own memories and association with him. I've known Max for nearly 40 years since the McLeod family first welcomed me in. And the things that resonate for me Max's absolute desire to communicate. Perhaps because of his deafness, he was really attuned to communicating using all methods available, verbal, visual. His body language was exuberant. He used hand gestures, broad facial expressions. He used the spoken word. And all of these means of communicating were used effectively by Max to make friends, to be understood, and in turn to understand. I remember Max as funny, sociable, generous, and welcoming. Whether he was out fishing, whether he was having a drink, whether he was having a smoke, whether he was at work or whether at home, Max was pleased to have people around and pleased to include them in whatever was happening. And so when thinking about a suitable Bible reading, this little passage from John's Gospel suggested itself to me, because it's a story that happens just after Easter, and the disciples are still confused about what has happened, and they're still confused about what to do next. And what has happened, of course, is still something we celebrate each year because it lies at the very heart of God's love for us. Jesus, because of God's incredible love for us, took to himself everything that was broken about humankind, everything that was wrong, all that was sorrow, all anger, all despair. He took it fully to himself and he put it to death on the cross with him. And this is what the first part of Easter is. By Jesus' death, he opens the way for us to God so that we might always know God's redeeming love for us. And the second part of Easter happens when Jesus then conquers death itself. On the third day, he rises from death because he has conquered it, and so that all who have given their life to him are also brought through death by Christ's person, action, and love. Jesus saves us because he loves us. But you see, the disciples are still coming to understand that. Sure, they've seen Jesus since he rose from death, but it hasn't yet fully sunk in. And so they go back to their old profession. They go out fishing. And through the long hours of the dark night, they lower their nets and raise them again, but they don't catch anything. And many of us will have been out all night fishing in the boat and not catching anything. It's certainly an experience common with me. And by the darkest time of night, they're tired. Their mood hasn't improved because they haven't caught anything. The questions in their mind and the confusion in their hearts still are not resolved. And I wonder, is this where we are today? Is this where our hearts are today as we come to farewell Max? Because Max's death is untimely. It's unfair. It's a shock. It is real. It is confronting. And the hurt is raw. The lad was only 52. And so alive in everything he did and everything he was. And many of us I know will have sat in tears over recent days, grieving. Maybe heavy with sorrow, maybe heavy with guilt, maybe heavy with all sorts of confused emotions. Many of us are tired, and we have questions in our mind and pain in our hearts. And this is why I think this Bible reading can speak to us, because at the end of the night, just as the light of the new day dawns, things start to change for the disciples. The despair of the night time turns into a new day of hope and of joy. From their boat, they see old mate standing on the beach, but they don't know who it is. And he tells them, let down your nets one more time. And when they do, and the catch is enormous, they realise it's Jesus on the shore. And Peter, in his joy, dives in off the boat and swims to Jesus. Their doubt is overcome. Their grief is set aside, and the new hope that is Christ's risen life takes root in Peter's heart. Because here is Jesus with them, risen from the dead. His promises are real. His hope of the good news is clear to see in the light of the new day. And Jesus is not frustrated that they are slow to understand. Rather, he has prepared a fire, a barbecue. And there is barbecue fish and bread to eat. And Jesus says to them, come and have breakfast. It's an invitation, a welcome to the hospitality of God. In the coming days, as you each deal with grief in your own way, maybe when you're out for a fish, think of Max and his love of fishing. Maybe when you're at a barbecue, think of Max and his love of socialising. Maybe when you're with friends, think of Max and his passion to communicate and to be included and include others. And maybe when you are with family, think of Max and his love for family and community. And think too that beyond your grief today is a God who loved Max and continues to love Max, and a God who loves us, a God who came to us in Jesus Christ to greet us, to feed us, to invite us into new life and fresh hope. A God who yearns for us to come to him through Jesus, that we too might taste and know eternal life, where God promises that he will dwell with his people and every tear will be wiped away and death will be no more. And this, my friends, is the hope we proclaim today as we entrust Max into God's eternal care, that we each might know that Jesus is with us in the darkness and confusion, and awaits with us the dawning of the new day, that we each in our hearts might have the new hope and new life that he offers, and that we might each have renewed confidence in Christ, that we might each know the power of God's love. So as we sit with this scripture in our minds and memories of Max in our hearts and the hope of the gospel all around us, let us take time and sit for a minute as I invite Shelley to come forward and offer us a song, The Power of Your Love.
Come to you, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. In the power of your love.
I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Let us turn now to God in prayer and pray with confidence to God the Father who raised Jesus Christ from the dead for the salvation of all. And thanks be to God for the gift of life. Loving God, you have made each of us in your own image, and you have called us to reflect your truth and light. And we thank you for Max's life. A life with many hurdles and obstacles that he met head on. A life of building friends, of drawing upon the strength of family and those who loved him, that he too might rise up. For his achievements, for his friendship, for his company, we praise you, Lord. And above all, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your gracious promise to all your servants, living and departed, that we shall be made one again in our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray at this time as well, Lord, for all those who grieve. We know you as a God of mercy and a God of comfort. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you will look graciously upon all those who mourn. Lord, as they cast their cares upon you, may they know the consolation of your love. And Lord, we bring our prayers together in the words that Jesus taught us. And please pray with me if you know the words. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We come now to the time of farewell, and shortly I'll invite pallbearers to come forward and carry Max out, and then we will follow in procession to Wreck Bay. I invite you to stand as I offer this prayer. My brothers and sisters, let us entrust Max to the mercy of God. Holy and loving Father, by your mighty power you gave us life, and in your love you have given us new life in Christ Jesus. And we entrust Max now into your merciful keeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, who died and rose again to save us, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Once in a while, let me hear from you. If we never meet again before my life is over, and they'll see me through. blossom without you. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I'll leave this world loving you. If we never